Almighty God, in you are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Open our eyes that we may see the wonders of your word, and give us peace that we may clearly understand and fully choose the way of your wisdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Today's reading from Genesis 1, sections 1 through 5. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. Word of God, wisdom of God, thanks be to God.
Our second reading this morning comes from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 1, verses 4 through 11. You can find it on page 34 of the New Testament. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And the people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed in camel hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one that is more powerful than I is coming after me, and I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandal. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." So in those days, Jesus of Nazareth, of Nazareth in Galilee, was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and a spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven and said, "You are my son, my beloved. With you, I am pleased." Word of God, wisdom of God. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Holy One, be with the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts, in order that they may be pleasing in your sight. For you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Two passages this morning. The first one, Genesis 1, you've heard this before. Yes. Have you forgotten I was gone 1 week? You've heard this before?
Yes.
Okay. We're pretty familiar with Genesis 1. In fact, in the beginning is a phrase we hear to call to mind this story. The Gospel of John uses "in the beginning was the Word" to call back to memory those that are reading this story in Genesis. In the beginning, there was God. And the waters were there. So before anything else, there was watery chaos. Yes?
Yes.
How exciting that we're talking about baptism today. And water. So I point this out to you because I want you to remember that from the beginning, there were two things. God, and what God does with water. Okay? So, jump to Mark. Mark is a fun gospel. Do you have a favorite gospel? This is just a pastor thing. This might be a pastor. You like John. A lot of people like John. Yes? Matthew? My favorite is Mark. Mark is my favorite. I confess that to you now. partly because in the Greek, I love the word ekbalo, which means to cast out. And Jesus is casting out a bunch of demons in Mark. It's all over the place. It was like the only Greek word I could remember. So I have a fondness for Mark. But in Mark, the fun thing about the story of Mark is that there seems to be two different levels of things that are happening. There's the human level that's happening, and then there's the Jesus otherly stuff that's happening. So there's the whole, all the conversations that Jesus has with a human. They have no idea who he is and no idea what he's talking about, and they're babbling, fumbling over themselves humans. But every demon Jesus encounters, every time there is an encounter with Jesus and the Spirit, the heavens are torn apart, and God is present in that moment. And the demons all know who Jesus is in every story in Mark. So there seems to be this two levels of stuff happening. Okay? With me?
Yes.
Okay. So you would think, right here at the beginning, there's two levels of things happening. And yes, there are. So the first thing we get is this description of John. I love this description of John. He's wearing camel hair. I can see like a Vanity Fair article. You know? Clothed in camel hair with a leather belt around his waist, he seems to be dining on locusts and honey. And did he in fact call someone a brood of vipers? Yes? So we get this description. And when I was young, I was this person in church who asked all the questions. Anyone been this person? Or know this person? Okay, I was this person. I wanted to know why John, if he was a good Jew, could eat locusts, because wasn't it a critter, and so couldn't that be unclean? Why do we get this description of this? If Jesus is being baptized, does that mean that he had sins? If he's coming to the water, then why do we come to the water? What happens in this story when the heavens open? Is Jesus the only one that sees the dove come down? What does it mean for us if there are a million questions that can come out of this particular text? And if you're wrestling with those, let's do it. Because I've wrestled with those. And I still wrestle with some of those. But the reason we get this description of John is because the gospel is trying to tell us that he is Elisha. Okay, I just made a big jump. Are you with me? No. Okay. The Old Testament Elisha. So, there was many people in the time of Jesus who did not think he was the Messiah, who thought he was foretold, because it was foretold that Elisha would return. Okay? So the Gospels that are written towards Jews, Mark and Matthew specifically, focus on John the Baptist being the reincarnation of Elisha. Okay? So the reason we get this wild description of a man with crazy hair standing in the forest, in the wilderness, at the edge, is all of that comes from Isaiah. You can pluck this description of Elijah straight out of Isaiah, and it's right here. So the gospel writers are trying to tell you that this is the prophet's return. John the Baptist is the prophet, and Jesus is the Messiah. Yes? Does this make sense? Okay, I'm making a big jump here. This is a big education morning. I take the teaching elder part of my title very seriously. Okay, so because
we believe that he, because we knew, the scripture tells us in the Old Testament that when John returns, he will preach the reconciliation and bring the reconciliation and forgiveness of sins, or Elisha will. So that's why John, in our story, is bringing the reconciliation and forgiveness of sins. Okay, that was a lot to swallow. If you check out for the rest of the sermon, that's fine. Munch on that. But don't, because that's awkward. Okay, so that's what's happening in this, in the first part of the story. On the human level, we've got human people coming to John, who's on the, in the wilderness, representing the edge. Told you about the wilderness. It's at the edge, reminds us of a place of redemption. We're calling back our time in Egypt. This is what's happening, okay? So the people are coming and they're being baptized, and so Jesus comes to be baptized. Now here is where all the questions start. Why, and et cetera, et cetera, okay? But I'm gonna talk about the heavens. So I'm gonna read that part again. Okay, in those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." So we have this beautiful, sacred moment. Were any of you baptized as adults? A couple of you. I was baptized in a river as an adult. And there is something about when you come out of the water. And the sun is shining. And it's bright. Because you've had your eyes closed, but you kind of want to see. Your pastor held you under the water a little bit too long. Because you needed it. But you come out, and there's, it's almost like this beautiful newness. And we kind of get this moment with Jesus and God. John puts him in the water, brings him out, and time stops. The heavens are opened, a dove descends, Jesus hears God's voice saying, "This is my Son, and I'm pleased with you." Now, I like to believe that that moment is just for Jesus. The people around John, nobody else, didn't realize there was anything in particular happening. But what changes is that Jesus is anointed into his ministry. So as we approach a new year, and we're coming to the waters today, and I pour these waters every Sunday, it's to remind you that something special happened just for you. Between you and God. A moment that you didn't have to share with anyone. A moment when you were claimed in a particular way, but you were already claimed before. Right? We knew Jesus was God's Son. We just spent 5 weeks talking about that. But in this moment, God says it to him directly. "You are mine, and I love you." So as we approach this year, I want you to remember that you're God's, that there is a relationship that you have that's special between you and the Lord. And sometimes there's stuff going on with you in your spiritual life that's not happening here on this human level or this church level, but interpersonally. But also, as we head towards the rest of the year, remember that the heavens get torn open every now and then. This is not the only time in Mark when the heavens get torn open. Powerful things happen when we can step into a moment and break free of the bonds that have us. And I know that it's my goal in a new year to break free of some things and step into newness with a relationship. And I hope that that's your goal too. Amen?